So with that, allow me to offer a special welcome to the distinguished guests who have joined for this special press conference, really, and release, who have lent their names to the preface of Hiding in Plain Sight in support of the report's conclusions. Carl Bildt, former Prime Minister and Foreign Minister of Sweden, Eugene Cholai, President of the Ukrainian World Congress, Ambassador Paula Dobryansky, former Undersecretary of State, U.S. Undersecretary of State for Global Affairs, Steve Hadley, former U.S. Assistant to the President for National Security Affairs, National Security Advisor, Adrian Karnitsky, non-resident senior fellow of the Atlantic Council, Gary Kasparov, Chairman of the Human Rights Foundation, Radoslav Sikorsky, Marshal of the Sejm, Oksana Siroyd, Deputy Speaker of the Ukrainian Parliament, who I just had the honor to meet. So thank you so much for being here as well. And of course, I warmly want to welcome Boris Nemtsov's daughter, Zhanna Nemtsova. Zhanna, are you here? It's so wonderful to have you with us. Later this evening, we'll honor your father and his work with our Atlantic Council Freedom Award. And thank you for coming here to help accept this honor on your father's behalf. The resolution of the ongoing war in Ukraine's east is critical to the future of the global order. The men and women on the front lines of Ukraine aren't just defending themselves, and that's part of the reason why the Atlantic Council cares so much about this. We would care about it even if they were only defending themselves, but they're also defending the rules of international engagement that have delivered security and stability in Europe and beyond. The conflict is also about the future of Russia itself and its proper place in a European community of equals. So there's a lot at stake here that goes way beyond the borders of Ukraine. That's why in February 2014, we launched our Ukraine and Europe initiative to galvanize international support for an independent Ukraine whose people are able to determine their own future. It's really that simple. The Council's work aims to strengthen Ukraine's security, preserve its territorial integrity, and advance democratic, economic, and governance reforms. So against the backdrop of this mission, the conversation today is focusing on a central question in the Ukraine crisis, one that we think is oddly still a topic of discussion. We hope that these reports sort of end that, which is the Kremlin's role in the conflict. These two reports argue that the war's toll, more than 6,400 dead, tens of thousands wounded, nearly 1.3 million displaced persons, is the direct result of Russian President Vladimir Putin's decisions and actions. Since the beginning of the crisis, the Kremlin has been waging a highly sophisticated hybrid war involving subversion, Russian leadership of armed groups, Russian weapons, Russian money, Russian propaganda, and regular Russian troops. All the while, Putin has insisted Russia is not involved in the conflict of Ukraine, and too many people have taken that as face value. Hiding in Plain Sight and Putin.War reveal the truth. Produced independently of one another, and I think this is one of the more interesting things about these two reports, is the way they reach the same conclusion from different sets of information, but reinforcing each other. Putin's Russia is at war with Ukraine, plain and simple. The Atlantic Council's report highlights Russian military involvement in Ukraine's east, drawing on publicly available information and innovative social media forensics. It reveals how Russia's military equipment moves into Ukraine. It reveals where training camps have been built on the border. And it pinpoints the Russian origins of cross-border artillery attacks on Ukrainian territory. It's a great privilege to be joined by Ilya Yashin, one of the members of Putin.War team that took up Boris Nemtsov's work following his murder on February 27, 2015. At great risk to their own freedom and livelihood, the team tracked down what was left of Mr. Nemtsov's report and published it in Moscow exactly 1 month ago on May the 12th. I'll first invite Mr. Yashin to the stage to present the findings of the report, and then after that, the Hiding in Plain Sight team, led by Atlantic Council Executive Vice President Damon Wilson, will present their findings. We'll then close with a panel discussion between several of our authors, moderated by Olena Tregub, the former Kiev Post correspondent and current director of international aid coordination, Ukraine's Ministry of the Economy. Olena is a remarkable journalist who I first met in Davos, the World Economic Forum, and a committed reformer. And Olena, is just wonderful to have you with us here today. So Mr. Yashin, the floor is yours.
Здравствуйте, уважаемые друзья, коллеги. Рад вас приветствовать и благодарен за тот интерес, который вы проявляете к тому, что происходит в моей стране. К сожалению, моя страна сегодня переживает очень непростой период в своей истории. Говорят, ничего не слышно. There are some technical problems. Still doesn't work?
Doesn't work. But что? Oh. It works?
Works. Good.
So, dear ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm very grateful for you being here, and I really appreciate your interest you express to my country and to the situation which is in my country.
Как вы знаете, уже 3.5 месяца назад в центре Москвы, у стен Кремля, был убит мой друг, товарищ, один из лидеров российской оппозиции, Борис Немцов.
As you know, 3 months and a half ago, my good friend, my colleague, the leader of Russian opposition, Boris Nemtsov, was killed in the central part of Moscow.
Борис Немцов был большим патриотом России, но в то же время он очень любил Украину.
Борис Немцов was a great patriot of Russia, but at the same time he loved Ukraine very much.
Немцов переживал как личную драму ту кровавую авантюру. Ту кровавую бойню, в которую Путин втянул наши страны.
For Boris Nemtsov, that bloody drama, which was organized by Putin in Ukraine, was his personal tragedy.
Последний месяц своей жизни Немцов посвятил тому, чтобы найти пути, возможности, как остановить эту войну.
The last month of his life, Boris Nemtsov devoted to searching and to finding the way out of that tragedy.
Последним делом его жизни была работа над докладом «Путин. Война», в котором он планировал собрать исчерпывающие доказательства присутствия на территории Украины российских войск.
The last thing he done during his life was his report «Putin.War», where he tried to gather all the evidences of Putin's war in Ukraine.
Немцов начал эту работу, собрал значительное число материалов, но, к сожалению, не успел ее закончить. Он был убит.
He started his work, he gathered a lot of material, but unfortunately he had no chance to finish this work because he was killed.
Эту работу продолжили его друзья, соратники, и примерно месяц назад, ровно месяц назад, сегодня 12 число, мы эту работу закончили и презентовали доклад «Путин. Война».
This work was done by his friends, by his colleagues, and today we are presenting his work, Putin War.
Нам удалось впервые под одной обложкой систематизировать все доказательства того, что на протяжении более чем года российскому обществу врут об отсутствии российских войск в Украине.
It is the first time when we systemize under one cover, in one book, all the information proving that during the last year Russians are being lied about the fact that there are no troops, no Russian troops in Ukraine.
Самая простая глава для нас была та глава, которая посвящена Крыму.
The most simplest chapter of this book was the chapter about Crimea.
Дело в том, что Путин сам во всем сознался.
The fact is that Putin told everything himself.
Однако для нас очень важно продемонстрировать эволюцию путинской риторики. Сначала Крымского кризиса до сегодняшнего дня.
It is very important for us to demonstrate the evolution of Putin's rhetorics from the beginning of the war until today.
Мы напоминаем российскому обществу, что в первые дни Крымской кампании Путин резко опровергал присутствие там российских войск.
We would like to emphasize that at the beginning of the Crimean conflict, Putin denied the presence of Russian troops in Crimea.
Путин говорил, что войска, которые орудуют в Крыму, это просто силы местной самообороны.
He told that those troops which were in Crimea were not troops, but simply self-defense groups.
Журналисты спрашивали, ну почему же они одеты в российскую военную форму, пусть без опознавательных знаков?
Journalists asked, why then those troops look like Russian military?
Путин говорил, ну, наверное, в магазине купили.
Putin told that those people bought in the shops everything, all the uniform and so on.
Спустя год в эфире федерального российского телевидения Путин прямо признался, это была военная операция.
So after the year have passed, Putin told it was a Russian military operation, and he told it on the TV, on the federal TV channel.
Путин подтвердил. Так называемые силы местной самообороны – это российский армейский спецназ, который незаконно действовал на территории Крыма.
Putin proved that those self-defense forces, so-called self-defense forces, were indeed the Russian special troops.
Мы напоминаем российскому обществу о Будапештском меморандуме, который был растоптан в результате путинской агрессии.
We emphasize that as a result of Putin's aggression, the Budapest memorandum was resolved.
В соответствии с этим документом Россия взяла на себя обязательство не просто признать территориальную целостность Украины, но и выступать ее гарантом.
In line with this document, the Russian Federation was not only to prove the territorial integrity of Ukraine, but also to defend this territorial integrity.
Мало кто помнит, что Украина заплатила за это немалую цену. Она добровольно отказалась от статуса ядерной державы.
And Ukraine paid a lot for these guarantees. They refused to use nuclear weapon.
Логика этого решения была абсолютно понятна. Зачем тебе ядерное оружие, если на Востоке есть огромный, мощный союзник, который всегда придет на помощь?
The logic was very clear. Ukraine didn't need such a weapon because they had neighbors who would defend in some circumstances.
Нарушив Будапештский меморандум, Путин растоптал международную репутацию нашей страны.
But Putin didn't meet the provisions of that memorandum, and that is why he ignored the reputation of our country.
Путин много раз говорил, на территории Украины нет российских войск.
Putin have told from a lot of times that there are no Russian troops in the territory of Ukraine.
Мы собрали свидетельства непосредственных участников боевых действий на востоке Украины, которые являются российскими военнослужащими.
We gathered direct words, direct proofs of people who took part in this operation, in this Crimean operation. And these are the proofs told by Russian soldiers.
Я приведу один яркий пример.
I will give one example.
Вот этот молодой парень, ульяновский десантник Николай Козлов.
This young man, Николай Козлов, he is a paratrooper from Ульяновск.
Будучи российским военнослужащим, вот он, в форме российской армии.
Being a Russian military, he is in the Russian uniform.
В марте 2014 года он участвовал в крымской операции в форме украинского милиционера.
In March 2014, he took part in Crimean operation in the uniform of the Ukrainian soldier.
После аннексии Крыма он вернулся домой, в Ульяновск.
After the Crimean annexation, he returned back home to Ульяновск, Russia.
Получил медаль за возвращение Крыма. Вот он в ней.
He received award for the Crimea, for
успел,
taking part in the Crimean operation.
Успел жениться.
He got married.
В августе 2014 года он снова был отправлен на восток Украины.
And in August 2014 he returned back to the eastern part of Ukraine.
Его отряд попал под обстрел, он был ранен и лишился ноги. Сейчас он инвалид.
He was wounded there and he lost his leg.
Эту информацию нам предоставил его дядя, включая фотографии.
This information was provided by his uncle. This information and these photos.
У нас собрано несколько подобных свидетельств.
We have gathered some of such proofs.
О тех солдатах, которые выжили, которые были ранены и которые погибли.
About those soldiers who remained alive, who were wounded and who were killed.
Отдельная глава посвящена присутствию военной техники, которая была переправлена на территорию Украины из Российской Федерации.
A separate chapter of this report deals with the military machines and techniques which were transferred from the territory of Russia, of the Russian Federation, into Ukraine.
Речь, в частности, идет о системе Торнадо-С и комплексе Панцирь-С1.
We are talking about system Торнадо-С and Панцирь-С1, S1.
Самый яркий пример – это, конечно, комплекс «Панцирь-С1», который сепаратисты, присутствие которого сепаратисты долгое время опровергали.
We're talking about the system «Панцирь-С1». This system is present in the territory of Ukraine. It is in the hands of separatists, but they denied having this system for a long time.
В нашем докладе вы можете видеть скриншот с автомобильного видеорегистратора в городе Луганске.
You may see in this report the photo, the picture, which represents the screenshot from, made in Lugansk.
Панцирь-С проезжает в городе Луганске прямо под билбордом с изображением лидеров самопровозглашенных республик.
This machine, Panzer-S, crosses the street under the billboard with the photos of leaders of a so-called republic.
Ну, к сожалению, я ограничен во времени.
Unfortunately, I am limited in time.
Хочу только добавить в финале своего выступления, что мы подготовили этот доклад, потому что мы являемся российскими патриотами.
I would like to emphasize that we have prepared this report because we are Russian patriots.
Наша задача – защищать национальные интересы России.
Our aim is to defend the national interests of Russia.
Мы убеждены, что путинская война, развязанная с Украиной, наносит огромный вред интересам нашей страны.
We believe that Putin's war with Ukraine makes great harm to our country.
Именно поэтому мы хотим его остановить.
That is why we want to stop him.
Спасибо.
Thank you.
As Ilya demonstrates, our work here is not about getting Russians out of Europe. It's about how to help them achieve a European Russia. I'm Damon Wilson, Executive Vice President at the Atlantic Council. I'm delighted to be joined by Eliot Higgins and Max Jepersky from our team of authors. You'll hear from Alina Polyakova and Ambassador Herbst as part of the conversation. We began this work with a premise that we do believe in a Russia that can find its democratic, peaceful place in a Europe whole and free. But it's this vision of a Russia in Europe that Putin himself, his actions have been undermining, if not mocking.
Finally, you asked whether our troops are present in Ukraine. I can tell you very clearly, there are no Russian troops in Ukraine.
So to set the scene for our report, hiding in plain sight, we listened to Vladimir Putin in his own words. I can tell you very clearly, there are no troops, no Russian troops in Ukraine. This is Vladimir Putin lying to his own people. In response to allegations of Russian involvement in Ukraine, Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov, said in January of this year, if you allege this so confidently, present the facts. But nobody can present the facts, or doesn't want to. So before demanding from us that we stop doing something, please present proof that we have done it. And when the U.S. government tried to do so, his answer was simply to rebuff it as if these are just images from computer games. Russian government officials have sought systematically to discredit information that's been released by NATO or the U.S. government as a smear campaign, as part of a concerted propaganda campaign, a hybrid warfare, if you will, with the aim to sow confusion and encourage or justify ambivalence in the West's response to this conflict. Yet the evidence is literally hiding in plain sight, a term coined by Ambassador Jeff Pyatt, who has joined us. So we believe that the best antidote to misinformation is to show the truth. So we took Minister Lavrov up on his challenge to present the facts. But we've also produced this body of research for a more compelling reason. If the international community cannot distinguish fact from fiction, or chooses not to, and chooses not to do so in public, it's unlikely that we're going to be able to coalesce around an effective strategy to support Ukraine and to deter Mr. Putin. This report is the Council's contribution to offer clarity. So we set out to tell the true story of Russia's war in Ukraine. This is no civil war. Rather, this is a story of regular Russian soldiers readied for combat at improvised bases along the Russian-Ukrainian border, backed by a steady flow of arms and equipment, and at times supported by the cover of cross-border artillery shelling. Our report documents each of these four elements of Russian involvement in Ukraine with specific examples to illustrate overall trends. And taken together, this evidence makes clear that the conflict in Ukraine's east is a Kremlin-manufactured war, fueled by Russian equipment, fought by Russian soldiers, and directed by Mr. Putin. We make this case using only open-source information, all unclassified material, and none of it provided by government sources. So let me turn this over to Eliot Higgins, who is the founder of Bellingcat, our partner in this endeavor, and really the brilliant mind behind many of the techniques we've used here. Eliot?
People love to share. People share all kinds of different things. They share pictures of their pets, pictures of their families, you know, pictures of their food even. But what we also find in Ukraine and in Russia, people share pictures of military convoys. And this is what we've used for our report, images shared by people of military activity in both countries. And what we've learned that these images can be used to establish all kinds of different facts. So for us, these images are very important because they allow us to collect a data set. A convoy that's passed through a village in one area might go to another location and is filmed by someone else. But more importantly is the key methodology of geolocation. Geolocation allows us to establish exactly where these images are taken. So I'm going to show you a very simple example now of geolocation so you understand what we're doing. This video is from July 17th, and this shows a convoy going through a town with a Buk missile launch on it. This, when it was first shared, was shared on Twitter, and it was shared with coordinates and a time. Now, we can't trust this information. We need to double check this information. So we do something very simple. We put this information into Google Earth, and it shows us this location. And it looks similar to what we can see in the video. We can see apartment buildings, but what else can we see? Well, if we use Google Earth imagery, satellite imagery available to anyone, we can start matching elements of the photograph to what's visible on Google Earth. We can match various structures visible in the image. We can also look at the layout of the roads and the paths. So this is a very simple example of what we can do. But not only can we track vehicles, but we can also track individuals, Russian soldiers coming from Russia into Ukraine.
Thanks, Eliot. So one of the soldiers that we found is Bato Dambayev, a member of the 37th Motorized Brigade. And we were able to trace him all the way back to his home region along the Mongolian-Russian border in Buryatia, Russia. And from there, we followed his path all the way, more than 4,000 miles, to a camp, one of those camps that I mentioned, near the city of Kuzminsk, where he took this picture. Now, from there on, he will embark to Ukraine, but what he did there first is what many other Russian soldiers do in Ukraine, and that is that they prepare for combat before they cross over. If you go to any of these locations, you can see, using Google Earth, and anyone else can use Google Earth, just go to that location and see how first, a year before the conflict, or a few months before the conflict, there was nothing there. But then, you see how there was a camp. And this is just a close-up of a gigantic camp that features thousands of soldiers. Now, Bato went from there, across the border, less than an hour, all the way to the Donbas, and he was posted at this checkpoint. And yet there he took this picture. And similar to the technique that Eliot explained a little while ago, we can go ahead and match up that picture with the location. Now this is a very generic matchup, and one will wonder, well, is it actually really working? Well, it is. Our friend Simon Ostrovsky from Vice News went ahead and checked out whether our mythology works, and he went all the way to that checkpoint, and as you can tell, it's literally that spot. Simon's documentation about this mythology is coming out next week on Monday, so you should all see it on Vice News. And it really gives you an idea how actually all of this works, and it's just remarkable proof that Eliot is right. Now, not every soldier that went to Ukraine came back. Part of it, but hundreds, maybe even thousands, didn't. They were shipped back in coffins under the termination Cargo 200, and it's only one of the really underscoring facts how high this toll is, not only on the Ukrainians, but also on the Russian public.
Thanks, Max. So these anecdotes and what you see in the report, all of this shows that Russia is at war in Ukraine. Russian citizens and soldiers are fighting and dying in a war of their government's own making. Indeed, Russian forces they've played defining roles at key moments throughout the conflict. And I think that's part of the story. From Little Green Men in Crimea, to seeding the initial violent rebellion in Slavyansk, to appointing a fabricated proxy leadership, including a known FSB colonel, to attempting to trigger uprisings from Kharkiv to Odessa, instigated by so-called volunteers and political tourists in an effort to create a so-called Novorossiya. And when that failed, to deploying the Chechen Vostok Battalion. And despite all this, in mid-June of 2014, Ukrainian forces began to take back significant territory. And Russia responded. Russia responded by sending in ever more sophisticated artillery, tanks, anti-aircraft missiles, including the Buk surface-to-air missile system that was used from Russian-controlled Ukrainian territory to shoot down Malaysian Airlines Flight 17 on July 17th. But don't take my word for it. If you put the tracking of the soldiers and the equipment together, the full real story comes to light.
On July 17th, there were photographs and images produced online that showed a Buk missile launcher traveling through separatist territory. Using the same techniques we used in hiding in plain sight, we were able to track that Buk missile launcher. Not only that, we were able to actually establish that it was also seen in June in territory controlled by Russia, going from Kursk all the way down to Milarovo in Russia. We started investigating more details about this convoy. We were interested in where this came from. We established it came from a place called the 53rd Brigade, and we started looking into the social media profiles of the soldiers. So we'd find photographs like this, so from one of the soldiers in the brigade showing the convoy itself. We'd also find evidence like this, where on the left-hand side, you can see a photograph taken by a soldier on a bus as they're in the convoy, and on the right-hand side, a video of the convoy with the same soldier fast asleep on the bus. They also posted images like this, their documents from their own unit that listed the names of the unit members. We managed to collect a huge amount of information, literally checking thousands of profiles, hundreds and hundreds of photographs. And what this has meant is we've been able to re-establish who was part of the convoy, who came from the 53rd Brigade, including over 100 separate individuals who are part of that same unit. And on July 17th, we're going to be publishing a new report that details the unit, members of the unit, how that unit is put together, which members of that unit were in the convoy that transported the missile launcher that shot down MH17 to Ukraine.
Thank you, Eliot. Following the downing of MH17, in response to Ukraine's counteroffensive, Russia resorted to using cross-border artillery strikes from Russian territory to push back on advancing Ukrainian forces. This is a chapter we cover in the report itself. So what do we take away from all of this evidence? What does this mean and why does it matter? So first, there would be no conflict in Ukraine today but for Putin's strategy to provoke one. We don't have a Ukrainian problem, we have a Putin problem, as Ambassador Herbst likes to say. Second, the best antidote to misinformation is to counter hybrid war is clarity. It's to speak the truth. And to do otherwise only reinforces Putin's attempt to obfuscate Russia's direct role in the conflict. It's why Western leaders must counter, not abet, Russia's hybrid war with their own plain language. After all, a prerequisite for policies that can better deter Russia's aggression is speaking clearly about Russia's role in Ukraine. Third, social media, these digital forensics, geolocation analysis, these are powerful tools. Information once available only to intelligence agencies is now literally hiding in plain sight for anyone to see. And this matters because it can help overcome differences among intelligence assessments and different capabilities, as we've seen among the NATO allies themselves. But it also helps overcome what might be a healthy skepticism among publics for official government intelligence sources, given intelligence failures of the past. You don't need to be an official. You don't have to have any access. You just need to be able to look at the information yourself. And the beauty of it is you don't need to trust us, even. You've now got a tool in front of you. You don't have to believe Eliot or Max. We've created a tool that folks can use themselves, and we don't control. It demonstrates a new reality in which individuals and non-governmental actors can play significant critical roles. And fourth, the report also for us serves as a warning. We've seen in advance of the Russian forces coming in and thousands, which produced Minsk 1, in the wake of Donetsk Airport and Debaltseve, the negotiation of Minsk 2. We've seen a strategy of Russia escalating to change the political terms of the deal on the table. And so what comes next in Ukraine, this is a potential warning. We've seen Russia has used the lull in fighting in the past to prepare for the next phase of conflict. In some respects, Putin is creating the reality of a separate fighting force so he can more effectively distance regular Russian forces from the conflict, and maybe even more persuasively try to make the case that this really is a civil war in Ukraine, regardless of its origins. And that's a trap that we must not fall in. But it's also a warning of what is happening across Europe and Eurasia. Russia's hybrid war isn't limited to Ukraine alone. There's a concerted effort to use propaganda, misinformation, and hybrid tactics, as we heard today from several ministers, to undermine countries like Moldova, Georgia, even Kazakhstan, to prevent the inexorable move of these nations westward, as well as those in the Western Balkans. And most dangerously, as we've heard from some of the speakers today, to divide NATO and the European Union by exploiting divisions within nations and among nations. And the ultimate goal may very well be to undermine the solidarity that's at the core of the Article 5 collective defense of the NATO alliance. Thank you very much. Thank you for that. We wanted to spend some time presenting a little bit of the evidence. We're going to turn over into a conversation now with those involved in this work. So I'm going to invite Olena Tregub to come forward with the other panelists that will continue the conversation. Olena is the Director of International Aid and Coordination at the Ministry of Economic Development and Trade of Ukraine. She was a journalist, an educator, a civic entrepreneur, and the Atlantic Council met her through her work with the World Economic Forum in Davos, and importantly for us as a member of our Next Generation programming at the Atlantic Council. Turn it over to you, please.
Thank you, Damon. Well, first of all, I wanted to thank all of you for those two reports. As a Ukrainian, I feel really strong about telling the truth and about your effort, actually, to tell the world the truth about what is happening in Ukraine. Because sometimes I just feel that the world doesn't care enough. And thank you for caring. I would like to start with Ilya Yashin. We were very saddened and shocked by the tragic death of the true friend of Ukraine, Boris Nemtsov. And as you mentioned, he was the one who did the major work for the report you are presenting today. I was wondering, in the light of his death, how do you think this report is being somehow used to change the public opinion of Russians? Because I feel this report now should be perceived by Russians as even more significant than ever. But I assume you have difficulties, of course, spreading information about this report.
Ответа на ваш вопрос.
Опять не работает ничего. Ну что ж такое? Okay, I will try to answer
maybe
in English. Yes. I'm not sure I have an answer on your question because actually we don't know what's happening with Russian public opinion this time. We know what propaganda says. We see the different picture when we speak with people face to face. Maybe we cannot change the public opinion. I don't know. But I know that we should try to do it. And I know that there is the only chance to change the situation in Russia, to change the situation in Russia and Ukraine relations, is to change public opinion in Russia. And this is the only chance to change public opinion in Russia, go to the people and tell the truth to them. Show the facts, show the arguments, and you know, just shake million hands. Because I have no goal to show the proofs of Putin's aggression in Ukraine to European politicians, to United States, to Ukrainian politicians. I believe all of them know very well what's really happening. But I would like to show the truth to Russian citizens. And that's why we finished this job, and that's why we are going to start the big public campaign, big civil campaign, to go to Russian regions and to show the people this report.
So do you plan to distribute this report? Because I read in preface that Boris Nemtsov actually said that he will go to people and just distribute
this.
Yes,
exactly.
That's what you are doing right now.
We have no television, we have no the national medias to promote our report. That's why we just go to Russian region. Actually, I had a number of presentations in Russian cities, in Yaroslavl, in Nizhny Novgorod, in Siberia, in Novosibirsk, in Ural, in Chelyabinsk, for example. And we have big plans about this. We will go to people, we will tell the truth, and we will see what will happen after. Maybe we will not get success, but we will try.
That would be excellent. Eliot, I would like to go to you right now and ask about your methods that you are now demonstrating to us, the fact-checking, the forensics that you basically use online without leaving your desk, the crowdsourcing information. It's very interesting that, as Damon said, those tools are now available to all journalists, not only to you. But why then not many of them are interested in using those tools? And many of them, if you look right now at different forums on CNN or some mainstream media, they still discuss whether there is a Ukrainian conflict or Russian invasion and don't start using those tools.
I found in my work, I started doing this with Syria a few years ago, and during that time I've spoken to a lot of journalists, I've spoken to activists. The issue always seems to be, you know, at the moment, an issue of awareness more than not actually wanting to do it. There's a lot of people who want to do this. It's just until I come and actually speak to them about it, they don't even know it's a thing that you can do. Mm-hmm. So a lot of my work is not just about, you know, doing the work itself, but it's going out there, telling people about it, saying you can do this yourself, because the techniques we use aren't hard to learn. It's something really anyone can do who's got a curious mind, and there's plenty of journalists who are still like that, fortunately. So if we can get out there and you know, teach people how to do this, activists, ordinary people, we can hopefully get more people doing it. And as it stands, the community of people who are actually doing this work is so tiny that every single person who starts doing it adds a tremendous amount to that community.
No. So now I turn to the authors of the report. Your task, as Damon explained, was actually to raise awareness about what's happening in Ukraine in Washington, D.C. And I have an obvious question. Do you think it will change the U.S. policy towards Ukrainian conflict and, in general, Western perception? And what do you think the West can do? I don't know, maybe Ambassador.
You know, you can't change public opinion overnight. But there's no question that this report has had an extraordinary outreach. Mm-hmm. Via Twitter, we know we touched over 60 million people. 50,000 or so downloaded the report as of a week ago, and that number is undoubtedly higher today. And it was very well covered in major media in the United States, in the continent of Europe, in Great Britain, and Canada. So it has had an impact. And it's part of a growing, you might say, body of information and body of analysis, which is helping policymakers and influential journalists wake up to the danger of a very powerful nuclear nation that is on the march in Europe. So it's certainly making a contribution. And through our and through the media techniques, which we are teaching via this report, its impact, its influence will only grow.
So, but it's not the case that after your report was published, the U.S. will rethink and provide lethal weapons to Ukraine, right?
From your lips to someone's ears.
Okay. Well, and Ilya, what about you? Do you think, we prove to Russians, we prove to Western world that there is military aggression of Russia, but what should we do about it?
So if we talk about the Western countries, about United States, about European countries, I think we have about 3 points. The first of all, support the Ukraine. Because if Ukraine fail, it will be a huge damage to Russian democratic movements, to European society. It will be huge damage. That's, I believe, you really should to support the Ukraine against Putin's aggression. The second point is personal sanctions against Putin's people, against Putin's oligarchs, against Putin's secret services people, against generals, against propaganda people. Personal sanctions. You know, some years ago, Nemtsov was became an author of the conception of sanctions against Putin's people. His idea was about to replace the sanctions against country to sanctions against individuals, to replace Jackson-Vanik sanctions to Magnitsky Act sanctions, and it works very well. Because, you know, Putin for a long time was a person who supported the economic interests of his staff. It was really comfortable situation when they stole money in Russia, but spent it in Western countries. Now it doesn't work because it's sanctions. And I believe that we should continue the sanctions and we should make it bigger. Actually, it really should work against propaganda people. I know it's a big discussion in United States and European countries, but I believe we should support these personal sanctions against propaganda people. And the third, what all of us we should do, support the political and civil activists who just under the pressure. There are a lot of people in Russia who go to prison, who under the pressure of police, of administrative resource, and all these people really need to know that if they are under pressure, there are people who will support them.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Alina, my question to you would be, how would you respond to critics who say that, yes, you prove that Russian military is present in Ukraine, but then many argue this war got out of Putin control, and if you remove the Putin problem, as Damon said, you don't remove the conflict. There was this article in the New York Times just recently that basically Russian civil groups and Russian local oligarchs are crowdfunding the war. And then it becomes not Putin's fault, sort of. Is it true?
Well, I think the New York Times article you referred to was quite terrifying as well. I think we're at a dangerous point. The conflict has gone on for over a year and a half now. And what we've seen, I think, as Damon said and as Ambassador Herbst often says, is that this was never a Ukrainian civil war. It was a Kremlin-made, Putin-made civil war, and I think all of us here understand that. But what we see happening now is that as local Ukrainians are being recruited and trained, what we are seeing is that the myth being made into reality, right? So it was never, there was never going to be a conflict in eastern Ukraine without Russian military interference. But because of the Russian military interference, and because the tactic has been to engage in a long-term, not a short-term basis, meaning to train locals who are, you know, frustrated with the situation, perhaps, to send in volunteers, mercenaries, and troops. So now what we're seeing is the production of this propaganda myth into a reality on the ground. And I think this is a very dangerous point. And because of that, I think it's so much more important now to highlight what is happening and to emphasize that no, what's happening now may develop into an escalated conflict that looks like a civil war, but that civil war was also manufactured by the Kremlin. And what's been interesting about the timing of all of these reports is that it was, you know, a wave of a campaign. As we were saying before, these two reports were independently produced, and now we're seeing more and more and more corroborating evidence coming out in the news, Russian soldiers themselves coming out, admitting or being frustrated about being sent by force, being compelled to fight in eastern Ukraine. And, you know, I think as this massive information builds, we're already seeing changes in public opinion, and which is what policymakers need to actually implement changes.
My last question to, like, the whole panel would be, given the fact that you studied the Russian war in such great detail, what do you think will happen next in the several months from now? Because, as you know, right now there is a paranoia among Russian military because of the Transnistria and no-fly zone that Ukraine announced there. And so maybe you think, is it possible for Putin to start some warfare in that region? And then also take into account that Crimea cannot be sustained without access to mainland Ukraine. What's your expectation? What's your feeling?
Most likely is we're going to see a continuation of low-grade warfare, incremental increase of Russian aggression to take more pieces of Ukrainian territory. But you might say, tenth of a kilometer by tenth of a kilometer, not more than that.
Like slicing a sausage.
At the same time, you'll see continuing effort to subvert key cities. We know that the FSB and the GRU have been focusing on both Odessa and Kharkiv. We know there's been efforts to talk about a Bessarabian People's Republic, a little bit to the west of Odessa. And these things will continue. If the Ukrainians continue to deal with the efforts at subversion successfully, which they have so far, and if they are able to make the Kremlin pay a price in casualties for this incremental aggression, we may not see much more. It's very dangerous for Mr. Putin to try and lunge deeply into Ukraine. One, because it gives up the whole pretense that his troops are not involved. And two, he will suffer substantial casualties. And while he may be able to take any city in Ukraine, he will not be able to keep it, because the Ukrainian people will fight back with a very nasty partisan war. So Mr. Putin's in a trap of his own making. And I think, again, he'll continue the tactics which have worked so far, which is small increases forward.
Ilya, what's your view from Moscow?
Actually, I don't think that Putin wants to have the Donbas or eastern Ukraine as a part of Russia. I believe that his strategy is to freeze the situation and to use the Donbas crisis as a mechanism of pressure on Kyiv authority, on Western countries, on United States. And Putin understands that he cannot have a pro-Kremlin, pro-Putin president in Ukraine in this future. But he thinks that he can use this situation on Donbas as a mechanism of pressure. He would like to make the situation when Western countries will accept the Crimea as a part of Russia, but he don't want to make the Donbas as a part of Russia. It's just a mechanism, and we have no idea what the Western countries will do with this. it will be a big mistake, in my point of view, if they will accept the situation, because it will be long, long crisis for Europe, for Ukraine, and it's very good for Putin. And that's why I believe it's not acceptable.
Okay, I would like to open the floor for questions. Please introduce yourself, your affiliation, and probably direct your question to one of the panelists. Yes, please, Adrian, or, no, okay. Yeah, you have a mic, okay.
Yeah, hi. Is the mic working? Yeah. We have a lot of evidence of Russian involvement, a substantial scale of involvement. Why is it not in Ukraine's interest to pursue the policy of having Russia recognized as an occupying power? We're speaking a lot about Russia using this beachhead to pressure Ukraine, but by recognizing it as an occupying power, Russia takes on a series of obligations, including the responsibility for policing any liabilities for attacks that these allegedly independent groups might wage outside. And it turns the onus for social support, for support for the infrastructure, for the care and feeding and nurturing of these people. And yet the Ukrainian government has been reluctant both in Crimea and in the East to follow that tack. In Crimea, and by the way, under the Geneva Convention, there is no recognition of sovereignty of a country if you invoke this claim of the status of an occupying power. So maybe you're not empowered to speak for your government,
yeah,
but I'm opening it to the panel. Is there any thought, is there a sufficient case to recognize Russia as an occupying power? And secondly, is it a desirable path to put additional pressure on Mr. Putin financially, morally, and in terms of future liabilities?
I can say a few words since I work for the government. First of all, we need a good lawyer, you know, international lawyer, who would help actually to make the case. And right now, also, you see, the Minsk agreement is that we will not say that those are occupied territories, and in turn, Putin will not escalate. It's sort of like there is this understanding, I feel, in Ukraine. And of course, this would be the solution, and many people in the government are pushing for this, but we just need someone to come and implement it and make it happen and have enough guts, you know, to stand up to Russia and do it. And I don't know, maybe some views from Ambassador or Eliot or Alina on that.
I think it's a very plausible tactic. And I think you're right that going that way is not seen as part of the Minsk framework. But we also know that there was a Minsk I agreement, and the terms of that Minsk I agreement were not bad. But then Russian aggression led to a Minsk II agreement whose terms were much worse. So it's clear that the Kremlin has not abided by Minsk. So I think it would be fully within Ukraine's right, and probably within Ukraine's interest, to find that good international lawyer who could make the case and add one more point of pressure to the growing pressure on Mr. Putin.
Okay, more questions? Yes, please, sir.
Thanks, I'm Jim Hasek from the Atlantic Council. I wanna give you a quick comment, I wanna ask you a question, and then I wanna explain why I asked my question. I think that might help the answer. And specifically to you, sir. I want to use a phrase that Steve Jobs at Apple used to use to describe it, insanely great. I love this, this is terrific. At the same time, I gotta say it's been a long time since I was a military officer, but I am honestly professionally offended, not by you, but by the Russian army. That is insanely bad operational security. So here's the question. I mean, honestly, if I were a front officer in the 37th Motorized Infantry Brigade or the 58th Air Defense Brigade, somebody would be getting some professional coaching at the moment, you know, in the ranks. So here's the question. Since you've released this report, or since it became clear that you were doing this work, have you seen a drop-off, maybe a sharp fall-off in the amount of social media postings that have been produced by Russian soldiers? Now, here's why I asked that question. I wonder sometimes if actually the Russian army is as badly led as some of its formations seem to be. And the reason thus I asked the question is I want to cite what something Mr. Kasparov said earlier today, that this is, I have the sense that Mr. Putin has a very weak hand, and that the military forces actually arrayed against NATO are not as impressive as he's giving us the impression, and thus we can be more confident about calling his bluff. What do you think about all that?
Well, if you want to know this about the strength of the Russian military, you can always go and look at their members' Facebook pages at the moment, because the amount of information that's out there is absurd. The 53rd Brigade, for example, where the Buk missile launcher came from, we've literally thousands of photographs from members of that unit. We could probably recreate their entire base from those photographs. Obviously, there's a huge intelligence interest in that, but also just from an investigative, you know, angle, that's hugely interesting. As for, you know, are we seeing less images? Not really. You tend to have a kind of reaction. You publish something about a photograph someone's put online, and then they'll sort of take it down or close their account. In many cases, they don't even bother doing that. One thing that's been very interesting to me as well is when, you know, there's been recent reports of dead soldiers. You know, very convincing reports, but all of a sudden they start posting again on their social media profiles. But they post very generic, boring things. And there seems to be an impression people are getting now that these accounts are being taken over and being used again to give the impression these people are still alive when they aren't. So there's, it seems very inconsistent the way they're dealing with this issue. You know, there's still lots of soldiers posting images online. A good example is we had a camp we were looking at, and we couldn't find any soldiers in the camp who were posting photographs. They were going out and getting drunk in the surrounding villages and posting photographs of that, but not in the camp, until one of them invited his girlfriend over to stay, and she took lots of Instagram videos, photos, geotagged all of them, so we were able to use that information as well. So it's just, you just need one, you know, mistake like that, and you start getting a lot of information from a site.
I just wanted to add to that, which is very quickly. You know, I think what's so fascinating and what's so powerful about this kind of work that Eliot's been pioneering is that you can't control people, right? You can't control how they use their social media. You can't control, you may be able to control a soldier, but maybe, but you can't control their girlfriend or their relatives or something like this. So this information is going to be out there. And what we have been seeing a little bit, I mean, part of this report was a bit of a fact-finding mission that the Atlantic Council team went on to Ukraine. And what we heard from Luhansk Oblast when we were there was that there were all of these anecdotal reports about Ukrainians who were living in these separatist controlled areas being asked to shutter their windows, there were curfews, their phones were being confiscated and destroyed. And so this just points to, there was jamming of the mobile nets, and this just points to the fact how this information is so incredibly powerful, and that in fact it's so dangerous that it reaches the top echelon of power in a place like Russia, right, where the president is then compelled to classify information about the deaths of soldiers even in peacetime.
Well, I still, we have a lot of more questions, but I was shown that we have zero time. Maybe we'll take one more from a Ukrainian former foreign minister.
Boris Tarasyuk. No questions, just two comments. One comment is that I would like to express gratitude to the authors of both reports, which are highly professional and may be used for, you know, as a proof in any case against Putin, Russia. A second comment is that during this panel, we heard some terminology like conflict in Ukraine or Ukrainian crisis, which are absolutely wrong, which may mislead anybody, while misleading the description of the event, you may apply wrong, mechanism. So I would like to urge everybody present here and who will work over the event not to use the terminology which is being spread over by Russian propaganda. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you all for attention. And I think the panel is still here, and you can approach them, especially the members of the media, for more comments, for interviews. That's why they are here. Thank you, everyone, and see you at the next event.